Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. This morning we welcome to the communion, to the communion rails for communion. If you would like to receive communion where you are seated, let the ushers know and they will bring communion to you. A work day has been rescheduled for Saturday, April 13th, starting at 9 o'clock a.m. That is going to be on Saturday, April 13th at 9 o'clock a.m. There is plenty of work that can be done both inside and outside. The more people we have here, the more we can get done. We will have soup and sandwich supper at 5 o'clock p.m. on Wednesday during Lent in the parish hall beginning on February 21st. All Lent offerings will go to Loaves and Fishes in Raymondville. Our coffee hour is from 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock a.m. Our Bible study is from 9 to 9:30 a.m. The noisy offering will be taken up the last Sunday of the month. And inside the bulletin, we did give you a printout, and this is the revised section of the Constitution that the Council changed the wording on it, so if y'all want to just take a look at that, and if any of y'all have any questions, feel free to call me, Patty, or any of the Council members, and we'll go from there. Do we have any other announcements? All right, let's go ahead and get started with the Lord is in His holy temple.
Lord is in His holy temple.
from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Okay. Holy and healing God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God, and he bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is found on page 107. Beneath the cross of Jesus, 107. Thank you.
The days are surely coming, says the Lord, new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. A covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall know, they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We will now read Psalm 51 in unison. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness. In your great compassion, blot out my offenses. Wash me through and through from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin. For I have no more transgressions, and my sin is never before me. Against you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. And so you are justified when you speak and upright in your judgment. Indeed, I have been wicked from my birth, a sinner from my mother's womb. For behold, you look for truth deep within me, and will make me understand wisdom secretly. Purge me from my sin, and I shall be pure. Wash me, and I shall be clean indeed. Make me hear joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Give me the joy of your standing among me, and sustain me with your beautiful spirit. The second reading is from the fifth chapter of Hebrews. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, You are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications, with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Having been designated by God, the high priest, according to the order of Melchizedek. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven and said that it was, I have glorified it and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said it was thunder. Others said an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. Word of God, word of life, this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Jewish men, Gentiles coming to him to listen to him. He knows that now is the time for the Son of Man to be glorified. There's going to be a change, and this is what was the plan all along. God's big plan is coming to fruition. Time after time, we've heard him say, the hour has not yet come, and yet now the time has come. And with that, he lays down another gem, something to think about. The law of life or the success in life, he says. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Now, we all know a little bit about seeds. It is amazing how seeds can transform our landscape and our homes from bare ground to beautiful flower beds or gardens. We know a little bit about seeds and how they germinate. We know that a seed consists of a productive seed coat, some kind of storage tissue with nutrient reserves, and a dormant embryo can be awakened to germinate and grow into a mature plant. Some botanists say that in every seed there's an on-off switch that will let the seed know when it's time to grow. So at some point the seed is turned on and it begins to sprout. In time, what was once a seed is transformed into a flower or fruit or a grain. For Jesus, planting seeds is what it means to be faithful. I like Eugene Peterson's interpretation of this passage in his book, The Message. It reads, listen carefully, unless a grain of wheat is buried in the ground, dead to the world, it is never more than a grain of wheat. But if it's buried, it sprouts and reproduces itself many times over. In the same way, anyone who holds on to life just as it is destroys that life. But if you let it go, reckless in love and trust in Christ, you will have it forever, real and eternal. Jesus says, whoever loves his life will lose it. These are people that are interested only in themselves. Their lives are judged by the money they make, the fun they have, the friends they have, but it has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. Those that hate their life or have a different vision of their life on earth will keep it now and eternally. Those who have their eyes on Christ and want to live their lives for him will have eternal life here on earth and in heaven. They have their trust in God in the midst of transitions and conflict and change. We have a young man in northern Minnesota that's now in the mission field. I talk with his parents up there. He's in a country that he's not even allowed to tell us where he is. He's sharing the gospel, and it's in a country that could end his life if they found out what he was up to. He's a very good-looking young man. A basketball star in high school, and a math graduate from Concordia College in Fargo, Moorhead. He could get a job anywhere he wanted to, but he has a calling on his life. Just like the Greeks, he wants the world to see Jesus, and to do this, he has to be willing to go and to share no matter what the cost. Because of the situation we're in right now, he's now back here in Illinois, sharing the gospel with Chinese students at the universities there. When a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it surrenders to a new life, and it bears much fruit. Nathan is bringing the gospel into a country that does not know him. Remember Gracie Allen? Some of you will. Who played the scatterbrained wife in a comedy team with her husband George Burns? The story goes that one day Gracie called in a repairman to fix her electric clock. The repairman fiddled with it for a while and then said, "There's nothing wrong with this clock. You didn't have it plugged in." Gracie replied, "Well, I don't like to waste electricity, so I only plug it in when I want to know what time it is. Guess I forgot." And that's the description of many of us about our Christian life. We save our religion for a rainy day, a fundraiser for the church or the Easter service. We go out unplugged and wonder why our lives are so devoid of power. How sad for us. Christian faith is not something to be plugged in when it's convenient or when it's necessary. The Christian life is lived daily, and there is a cost involved. The world is entering upon a period of catastrophe and crisis where we are being forced to take sides, and in which a higher and more intense kind of spiritual life is going to be, or is, demanded of Christians. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him, Jesus said. He humbled himself and became obedient until death, even death on a cross. And because of that, God has bestowed on him the name which is above all other names in heaven and earth. If we wish to be where he is or anywhere in the neighborhood, we could reach that only by traveling behind our master in the same direction and on the same road. Jesus had a passion, and that passion was us and the world. If we were the only people in the world, he would have died for us. He would rather go to hell for us than descend to heaven without us. That's what he came for. He was obedient until death. Not my will, but thy will, dear Lord. His cross came first, and because of it, you and I are empowered to carry our own. We are his workmanship, his first fruits. The cross is indispensable. For in it we learn of God's love, his willingness to take our sins upon himself, and his willingness to place his righteousness upon us. The Christian author, Walter Wangerin, had a wonderful story called Matthew 7, 8, and 9, about how he tried to stop his son Matthew from stealing comic books. He tried various uses of the law over several years and continued to fail. Finally, he resorted to something he rarely used, a spanking. He did it deliberately, almost ritualistically, and he was so upset when he finished that he left the room and started to cry. After pulling himself back together, he went into Matthew's room and hugged him. A number of years later, Matthew and his mother were doing some general reminiscing, and Matthew happened to bring up the time when he kept stealing those comic books. And you know why I finally stopped, he asked. Sure, she said, because Dad finally spanked you. No, replied Matthew, I stopped because Dad cried. The last week of Jesus' life is called the Passion for this reason. God weeps for the sins of the world, and in his broken body, our lives are made whole. We want to see Jesus. May that be our prayer. Our sermon hymn this morning is found on page 148. Now the green blade rises, 148.
Thank you.
God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Please join me in the prayers of the people. Lord God, forgiver of our ever sin, remind us to forgive and forget the wrongs that have come upon us by others. Help us joyfully receive and joyfully give grace for ourselves and for others. The day of the Lord is coming.
He abounds in steadfast love.
Holy Spirit, help us understand that all of our sin against another is mostly a sin against you. Wash us with your forgiving love, and we shall be whiter than snow. The day of the Lord is coming.
He abounds in steadfast love.
Teach us your laws, Lord God, and as we meditate upon your wisdom, help us follow your guidance and decrees. The day of the Lord is coming.
He abounds in steadfast love.
Great physician, reach out to those whom we name in need of help and healing. Evangeline Deese, Jared Basker, Helen Hoffman, Martha Sorensen, Andrew Hoffman, Jimmy Herring, Joel Humphreys, Arlette Cole, Stacy Roberts, B. Cantu, Karina Ortega, Betty Redfern, Cody Parker, Joe Marine Thomas, Dorothy Galley, Cameron Lopez, Quinn Whitfield, Eduardo Castillo, Julie Wilde, Ellen Ballinger, Robert Ballinger, Suzanne Reagan, Phyllis Breyer, Dolly Montoya, Susan Tate and her family, Chris Cruz, Beth Stewart, Mike Fonseca, Zelma Fox, family of Lloyd Galley, Alan Sager, Henry Anderson V, and his power lifting team, foster families, all members of the armed forces, all law enforcement, and first responders. We lift all those who have not been named here, either out loud or in the silence of our hearts. Sonia Engstrom. May God's healing presence give them peace and hope in their time of need. For those who have experienced your unconditional love, we thank you, gracious God. The day of the Lord is coming. Lord Jesus Christ, even as you submitted to the will of our Father, even unto death, help us give in willingly to your superior way. The day of the Lord is coming.
He abounds in steadfast love.
Lord Jesus Christ, like a grain of wheat in spring soil, so you have risen from the grave. Help us become your living fruit by seeking your lordship in all that we do and say. The day of the Lord is coming.
He abounds in steadfast love.
Heavenly Father, even as Jesus' soul was troubled when death came near, draw us near to you in the hour of our dying, that we may be reunited with all the saints. The day of the Lord is coming. He abounds in steadfast love. Dear Lord, bless Daniel Hugo and his family and the work that they are doing in Mexico as they train the next generation of missionaries to go out and spread the gospel to all the nations of the world. The day of the Lord is coming. He abounds in steadfast love. God of peace, we pray for all people living in countries at war. We pray for all of those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace, for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. Above all, we pray for all your precious children, at risk and in fear, that you would hold and protect them. The day of the Lord is coming. Amen. He abounds in steadfast love. God of truth, we thank you for your ongoing reformation activity in the church. Continue to lead your people to return to faithfulness. We pray for Lutheran congregations and Mission for Christ, and ask that you guide the missional leadership of our association staff members, Mike Bradley, Christian Hundley, and Julie Smith. We also celebrate and lift before you the ministry of the Danbag Lutheran in Danbag, Texas, and their supply pastor, David Kite. We pray for their discernment in the call process. Bless their work for your kingdom's sake. The day of the Lord is coming. He abounds in steadfast love. Though we remember we are dust, and to dust we shall return, we remember that we are your precious dust. Amen. Continue our morning worship with the offering.
Right and salutary.
You bid your people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. Renew our zeal in faith and life, and bring us to the fullness of grace that belongs to the children of God. And so the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Built on nothing less. 294.